Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
When you have got a question and you just can't figure it out, just give us a shout and call the Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline. The Homework Hotline.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaremba.
And I'm Sam Simpson. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Here's how it works. Teachers from Dial-A-Teacher are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you would like help with your homework, call Dial-A-Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
You can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your question.
It's Monday, and that means it's time for our math maze.
Tonight's math maze is: half of Lisa's workspace is covered in paper. One third of the paper is covered in yellow sticky notes. What fraction of Lisa's workspace is covered in yellow sticky notes? Be able to explain your answer?
We'll give you a few seconds to write this down again. Tonight's math maze is: half of Lisa's workspace is covered in paper. One third of the paper is covered in yellow sticky notes. What fraction of Lisa's workspace is covered in yellow sticky notes? Be able to explain your answer.
If you think you can solve the math maze, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Remember, every correct response and will be added to our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
Excellent.
I think we got a question for you.
We did. Someone sent us a question. It's up on the board. I'm going to go do it.
Great.
Alrighty, cool. So we have a ninth grader called in, Aaron submitted this question. It says, change 2x plus 4y equals 800 into the slope-intercept form. All right. On a line, and it says name the slope, the y-intercept, and explain how to graph this in slope-intercept form. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to write down the slope-intercept form, and that is equal to y equals mx plus b. Now, when I do this, I tell my students when I was teaching and helping with math is, let's explain what these things are. When we look at this right here, this b, the number that you get there, represents your y-intercept. All right, this is where, C-E-P-T, this is where your line will cross the y-intercept, hence y-intercept, all right? The number, the letter here, the m in front of the x is equal to the slope, all right? And slope is, sometimes you see it as a triangle x, which is delta x, or the change in x over the delta y. Some teachers will say it's this rise over your run, okay? So this is the actual slope of our line. So now we have to go back to our equation here. We're going to pull out this, the 2x plus 4y equals 800, and get it into y equals mx plus b form. All right? So let's write it out here. We have 2x plus 4y equals 800. So now I want to get y by itself. So the first thing I have is 2x on one side. I want to move it over to the other side of the equation. So I have a positive here. I'm going to subtract 2x from one side. That means I also have to subtract 2x from the other side. And seeing that I want it in the mx plus b form, I'm going to actually put the subtraction in front, but because it's right here, I'll show you how we finagle that around. 2 minus 2 is going to cancel out, which means I have plus 4y equals, again, I have subtracted, I'm going to put minus 2x, and that's a positive plus 800, all right? So I'm not finished yet. We have to get the y by itself. So it's a 4y, that means it's held to the y, the variable, by multiplication. We have to do just the opposite. That means we are going to divide both sides by 4. And you'll notice I'm doing each component by 4 because we need to get our slope in a y equals mx plus b, and our slope is a rise over run. So this will help demonstrate that rise over run. 4 divided by 4 is a single 1. And remember, now that we're in ninth grade or higher math, I don't have to put a 1 in front of the y. I can just leave it as y. Y equals, I'm going to carry is minus 2x all over 4. And plus 800 divided by 4 gives me 200. All right? So now, you know that when we all work with fractions, I have to reduce my negative 2x over 4. So I'm going to do that now. So I have y equals 2 divided by 2 is going to give me negative 1, and 4 divided by 2 is going to give me 2x plus 200. So now I have just taken our original equation, 2x plus 4y equals 800, and converted it into our slope formula of y equals, here's our m, our slope, all right, that's our m, and this is our b, our y-intercept. Now, this is a huge, huge number. So if I was to show you how this would look on a graph, and our scale is going to be way crazy, all right? So I'm going to draw a coordinate here, and this is my x, and this is my y. And because my y-intercept means I'm at 200, I would go, let's go by hundreds. There's 100. Here's 200. 200, and this is 100. All right, now if I zoomed in just on this part here, because that's where my line is actually going to cross, I'm going to go way over here. So you don't even see down here. And if we have 200 here, and this would be like 201 and 202, and this would be 199 and 198. All right, I can't see the lines way down here, but these are all really, really small together. All right, so I know though that my line here is going to cross at my y-intercept at 200. That's where the line is going to go through. Now, one of the things I know right away is this is a negative slope. So it doesn't matter how I graph it, my line is going to look downhill like this. It's going to be a negative hill going down, and that's a good way, a good way to check. If you have a negative, it's going to be a negative slope. You're going to be sliding down the hill. All right. If it was positive, I'd be going this way and be climbing up the hill. All right, so now because my numbers are so small, the rise over run means I have to come down 1 and I'm going to go over 2, and I would put a dot. And for a line, you actually need to plot, you need 2, but 3 is even better. So I'm going to go the other way. I'm going to come up 1 and over 2. All right, and because my scale over here, these would be so small, be here. When I draw this, I'm going to get a line that's going to go like that. On this one here, it would be a very, very steep slope. All right, because your scale and because of this number here being so large, it's kind of difficult to graph. But at ninth grade, once you get your y equals mx plus b form, you put it in the calculator, you can zoom right in on where that crosses the y-intercept, and you can look at it, you can do all your variables and all that stuff. So I'm going to put a box around my answer here so my teacher knows exactly, and then when I go to graph, I could explain to my teacher, this is how you do it. The negative slope goes down, rise over run, and my y-intercept. So I hope that helps you out, and that was a good question. Thanks a lot.
Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial a Teacher is open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
Y equals mx plus b.
Well, you're going to do a lot of those.
Right.
Yep.
So you have a question you're going to
work? I've got another one up.
Right.
I've got a problem on the board that might help you with those of you who are in eighth grade with that state exam that's coming up.
Ooh.
Let's go take a look. So I've got this function. It's got some straight lines and some curves. Starts over here at negative 4, goes up, comes down, goes back up, comes back down. The question they ask, for which interval of x is this function decreasing and nonlinear? So I wanted to look at when is it going down and when is it nonlinear? Two distinct things. So what I like to tell my students about knowing whether a function is increasing or decreasing is always start on the left. When you reach whatever your line is, what does it do? If it's going up, it's increasing. So if I'm coming here, notice when I hit this line, it's going up. So this is increasing. Where else is increasing? Here, now I'm going down. So I'm going to put a little signal symbol here that says it's increasing there. Here it's going down. So here it's decreasing. If I keep going along, notice it's increasing again. Notice here it's decreasing again. So I am looking for which interval of this function is it decreasing. So if I look for decreasing, I'm looking for either that interval or that interval. So I'm looking either here or there. Those are my two intervals I'm looking for because that's where it's decreasing. But they have another little caveat here. They want to know when it's nonlinear. What does that mean, nonlinear? The best way to think about it is it's got line in there. So if it's got a line, then it's linear. So I'm looking for one that's not a line, but a curve. So if I look at this one, notice that that's a straight line. That one's linear. So the one that I'm looking for is, it's kind of like highlighted here. It's this area. It's not going to work for me. Oh, well. So what it's doing, let's clear this up so we can see it better. The interval that I'm looking for is this area right in there because it's nonlinear and it's decreasing. So the interval is always dictated by the x values. So I want to look here and I'm seeing here it's increasing. It starts to decrease when x is equal to negative 2. And it stops decreasing when x is 0. This particular problem was a multiple choice question. So I'm looking between negative 2 and 0 would have been my answer. That particular problem is one that will help you out for that 8th grade exam. Couple of things you want to remember. Linear versus nonlinear, increasing versus decreasing, and how to do that. I hope that helps you out on that exam coming up in just a few weeks.
Having trouble remembering where the numerator and denominator go in a fraction? Just remember that D in denominator stands for down. So numerator over denominator.
Homework Hotline has teamed up with the Golisano Foundation to bring you a series called Move to Include. We'll be taking a closer look at how to include people with intellectual and physical disabilities. In this week's Move to Include video, we meet Carrie. Carrie has been living with multiple sclerosis and will be teaching us about how the disease affects her, what sort of technologies help her through the challenges of her that she faces every day in life. Take a look.
My name is Carrie Giesen, and I'm 43 years old. I've had MS for 16 years, and we are here today talking about MS, which is multiple sclerosis, and its effects on people. Some of the symptoms of MS range from cognitive loss of ability to physical loss of ability. It can be anything from memory loss, speech issues, and to physical issues with walking and balance, spasticity issues, heat intolerance, cold intolerance. Those are really the big ones. Multiple sclerosis affects the lining of the nerves. And the way I like to explain it is like an electrical cord, with the outer part of the electrical cord being wrapped in, you know, the rubber part of it. And in MS, the coating on the nerves is called myelin. And because MS is an autoimmune disorder, the body attacks the myelin. And when that happens, the nerve signals that come from the brain to the different parts of the body are confused and slowed down and whatnot, because that nerve signal can't travel as quickly, or it gets messed up along the way because the myelin has been degraded. We do a lot of outside errands. Since I have hand controls, I can drive anywhere, and I either use my walker if it's going to be a short walking distance, or I can use my wheelchair that I propel myself if it's going to be a longer trip. So I can take my kids to the zoo, to the science museum. Really, we go anywhere that any other family could go. Around the house, we're really, you know, the same family that anybody else would be. We just do it a little bit differently. So we love to play games. We love to bake. We garden. The kids help me garden, although that's not one of their favorite activities.
You know what?
The kids are gourmet chefs because they help with dinner now. They help with a lot of chores around the house. Using adaptive equipment really is key. And a lot of people fight using adaptive equipment because it may carry a certain stigma, or they may feel they look a certain way, they may feel they look disabled. But once they can accept that and get over it, adaptive equipment really is fundamental to living well with MS. Staring at someone can be very hurtful. Smiling at the person and saying hello goes a million miles. If you're 4 or if you're, you know, 89, just smiling at someone and acknowledging the person with a disability is the best thing that anybody can do.
Megan Hill. Yes,
it's like a dandelion thing. Yeah. I have a couple friends that actually have. One's in very advanced stages, and the other friend is progressing. And it's debilitating. I mean, eventually you're in a wheelchair, which is
right.
Sad.
One of my best friends in college had MS, and one of the positive things is they have a lot of equipment.
Yes, adaptive stuff.
That helps you increase your quality of life.
Yep.
If you would like to see this video again or others like it, visit our website, homehotline.org.
All right, I have the nervous system. I'm going to go over and continue with that.
Great.
Cool. So as Carrie was mentioning in the Move to Include segment there, the myelin sheath is just like on the axon of the neurons. And this is where it transmits nerve cell from nerve impulse to the next nerve cell, goes down this little channel here. So the autoimmune multiple sclerosis actually causes these myelin sheaths to be degraded, and then the signal doesn't get sent down the line but transmits out throughout, and it causes all kinds of problems. So our nervous system is divided into two major systems, all right? Our first is the central nervous system, or the CNS. This consists of your brain and your spinal cord, all right? This is the major processing unit of our body. Without a brain, we're not much of anything else. So this thing controls everything in your body that's going on, all right? The central nervous system is also, or our nervous system also has a peripheral nervous system. So if you think of like if you're looking straight out and you put your fingers out like this, you can kind of see motion at the very sides of your vision. That's your peripheral vision. The peripheral nervous system is kind of just like that. This is the stuff outside of the nerves, the spinal cord and the brain. It connects the brain and the spinal cord to everything else in our body, all right? So when we look at our central nervous system, this is the brain and the central processing, the spinal cord, all right? Our brain has three main parts. We have our cerebrum, which is the largest part of our brain, and it looks very much like this. This is a model or an actual picture of a human's brain, all these convolutions in here, and on this are different sections of the brain that correspond to different senses that we have, all right? This cortex is the outer part of the brain. This is where your thinking takes place. This is where your senses are located. So this is the front part of the brain. Out in the front, we have our prefrontal cortex out here. This is our personality. It's kind of our who we are as a person. If that ever gets damaged, you forget who you are, your behavior changes, stuff like that. In the very back of your brain, right back here, is your optic nerves, where they connect from your eyeball back here, and it's processed here. Right around the side here is your hearing. So if you ever know someone, or like in Rochester, we have a very high deaf population. We have cochlear implants, or people that have cochlear implants, and what that is they actually insert an electroprocessor right there in the side of their brain that connects to that hearing section in the brain, all right? A little farther back in the brain, we have the cerebrum. This is that bottom portion right here. This is where it controls voluntary muscle coordination, your walking, your balance, things like that. Your brainstem, which is a little bit farther down, connects the cerebrum, the cerebellum, and then the signals come out of the brain, out to the body, is where your brainstem is. And this extends down into the spinal cord. This is responsible for involuntary actions, breathing, coughing, blood pressure, heart rate, things like that. Right here they are. And sneezing, vomiting, and swallowing. So if you ever get in an accident and that gets damaged and those things don't work properly, Outlook is not very good. So when we go back and we'll do a quick rehash here again, we have our central nervous system and what it encompasses, and also how we have this peripheral nervous system, which is an outlying system that connects your senses, your body, to the brain or the CPU of you, like in a computer. So I hope that helps you guys out. Thanks a lot.
Fraction help. How to change a mixed number into an improper fraction. Make it mad. M, multiply the denominator by the whole number. A, add the numerator. D, denominator stays the same.
Wow.
Cool.
Stuff. Brain stuff.
Yes.
I got another basic problem for eighth graders to help you out with on the board.
All right.
Let's go take a look. This particular problem, I've got a graph here, and I've got a line through it. This particular angle is n plus 18. This particular angle is 2n. They want to know, what is the value of n? A lot of ways I could do it. But one of the things that you learn in eighth grade is anytime angles are right across from each other, they're congruent. So if this is 2n, I know that that is 2n. And then this little right triangle means this side is 90 degrees, and I know that all the way across is 180 degrees, which means this has to be 90 degrees. So with that information, I can set up an equation and solve for n. I have two angles that add up to 90 degrees. So I'm going to go n plus 18 plus 2n is equal to 90. Now all I have to do is just solve this equation for n. Add like terms. 3n plus 18 is equal to 90. Subtract 18 from both sides. 90, take away 18, I'm going to get 72. 3n is equal to 72. Now what I need to do is divide both sides by 3. 3 goes into 72. 2, 6, 1, 2, and I get 4, and there is my answer. N is equal to 24. So they're going to give you some potentially some triangles or some graphs with some angles on them, and you're going to need to know supplementary, complementary, and they add up to either 180 or 90 degrees. Hope that helps in that upcoming exam.
An easy way to remember order of operations is to use PEMDAS, or the saying, "Please excuse my dear Aunt Sally," which stands for parentheses, exponents, multiplication, division, adding, and subtracting.
Hi, we have Eve on the phone.
Hi, yeah.
You're our winner. What's our answer to our math maze?
1/6.
1/6. How did you figure that out?
Okay, well, so the problem Okay, so, well, 1/2 of a whole, obviously, is a half. And a third of that, I figure out, is a sixth, because when you multiply 1/2 times 1/6, then you get, or sorry, I'm sorry, 1/2
times 1/3,
you get a sixth, 1/6.
Very good. So what you want to do, excellent job, Eve. I'm going to go over a couple of pointers for some of our audience. Some people were kind of adding. Anytime you see of, with fractions, that should throw off something that says you're going to need to multiply. So literally what you want to do, we had this whole thing, we took half of it, and then what we had to do is, of one of these halves, we had to take a third. And if you look at the whole thing, it's only 1-6. Good job, Eve. Did an excellent
job.
Thank
you.
Congratulations. Every correct response goes into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. And like Eve, if you earn enough points, you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
That's all that we have time for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dollar Teacher's available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
Tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we visit Wild Things to learn about Great Horned Owl.
Bye, guys.
Presented as part of Move to Include, made possible with support from the Golisano Foundation. Learn how you can be more inclusive of people with disabilities. Log on to homeworkhotline.org. Click the Move to Include button.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.